Let's appreciate Pastor Millicent. Whoa! Yes. Let's also appreciate the young man that was here, Samuel Godo Karaoke. Wow. We bless the name of the Lord. Let's get seated. God is good. God is good. Are you sure God is good? You know, if you're the testimony, then you should really know it. God is good? You know, sometimes it's good to know whether people know that you are the testimony. God is good? And all the time? Now, I think it will be proper for you to look for someone, actually, who doesn't appear like they know what they are talking about. And then you tell them, I mean it. God is good to me. Because I'm the testimony. And by the way, some of us argue a lot. Don't argue with their testimony. Please tell someone what God has done for you. Since the last time you met, could be on Sunday or Monday, whatever it is. Just open your mouth. Please. Hata kama ni mtu tu amekunulia chapo ama mandazi hapo njiani, ama ile sausage inakuaga pale vijana, eh? You know, we appreciate what God has done for us. Amen. It's also good to know that I'm glad you came. Actually, I'm so glad you came. Maybe you might not know, but tell your neighbor, please believe the bishop. He is glad you came. I'm so glad you came. And I pray that you'll be coming even tomorrow and also on Friday. Revival. What's a revival meeting? A revival meeting is a place you go and you are so eager for God to revive you. You're so eager for the Lord to speak in an area in your life that needs some energy. You are so excited to get into a place where you can focus for 2-3 days that God will reveal himself. And God is good. There are some of us whose life will never be the same. Why? Because they have come and they have decided that God would minister to them. I also know, tell your neighbor, the bishop also knows, that there are some of us, kazi yetu ni kusindikiza wengine. Let's tell them, hata wakusindikisha asanti. Hata wakutusindikisha asanti. But our prayer is, we don't sindikisha anybody. Gari ya kwenda ikija tuingie ndani. I know some, Kenya we like runners. In Beijing, is it Beijing or one place? No, in Congo. There is a Kenyan that was supposed to go and pay set for the others. Aka pay set. Alafu kaenda, akakitoa. Wakamtafuta, wakamkosa. Tell your neighbor, I might be a pay setter, but this one itakuacha. Amen? Bless the name of the Lord. Huyo msichana alienda. Paka wakasema, she was supposed to be the pay setter. Lakini alienda, akapewa hiyo gold. Na juzi, Uhuru alimpatia million. Can you imagine? There are some of us that God is going to give us great, great blessing. Remember the story that my wife shared here not long ago of this pastor that was looking at the choir. Choir, you know, akaona ni sauti moja tu, inasikika binguni. You know, that caught me. That anywhere I go, I want to be the voice. That when God listens in heaven, he can hear my voice. So that my sacrifice is also accepted by God. Now that is the kind of a life that I want to live. Bless the name of the Lord. Tell your neighbor, thank you for coming. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. The speaker that is coming to speak to us, Yo Mugeni, sisi ambao tulisoma kisomo cha zamani, kule miaka ya stini, kulikuwa na kitabu kadogo, tulikuwa tukifundishwa, ka Kiswahili kalikuwa kisema hivi, mgeni siku ya kwanza, mpe wali na biriani, mpe vinono, mgeni siku ya kwanza. Mgeni siku ya pili, punguza ule unono. Siku ya tatu mpe jembe, akalime. Na mgeni mhubiri wetu, tutapunguza unono kwa sababu ya kesho, tutampa jembe alime pamoja nasi. Sasa, kwa hivyo John sio mgeni, hii hata siku yake ya pili, ya tatu, amekuja tena kutuletea neno la Bwana. anakuwa akiomba na sisi tumekuwa tukimuombea ili neno alilolibeba liwe ni langu na liwe ni lako. Bwana Yesu apewe sifa. Ukienda kwa daktari, tuseme sasa umeenda kwa daktari, anakuuliza gaje? Unasikiaje? Alafu kuna swali lingine ambalo linakuwa kali sana. Hebu niambie historia ya kwenu. Nani mwingine ameshapatwa na hii ugonjwa? Na leo tumekuja kwa daktari na ni Yesu. Na anatuuliza, ni nani katika laini yako amepata muujiza? Is there someone that you know that has received a miracle? And if the answer is yes, you can even turn it around and say, I am the person who has received the miracle. And today, I'm ready for God to speak a word in my spirit. John, wacha tuwacha kupiga round. Lete neno Bwana. Let's appreciate the servant of the Lord, John, as he brings the word of God to us tonight.
Hallelujah. Let's give Jesus a hand clap of praise today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. We worship you and give you praise. Hallelujah. Lord, we love you and we honor your name tonight. Thank you for the wonderful blessing of being together. We thank you for the grace of your presence in our midst, O God. We worship and exalt and magnify your name. And we pray tonight that the Holy Spirit will have his way in our lives and in our midst in the name of Jesus. Lord, I submit my heart and humble myself before you and pray that, Father, you'll speak through my mouth today. Lord, thank you for this wonderful congregation, wonderful bishop, wonderful people. I pray, Lord, that God, today my heart will be available for you to speak through. God, that you might impart and speak that which you desire even for this wonderful congregation. We thank you and we bless you. We pray and believe, Lord, that at the end of our time together, we shall be able to say it has been good to have been in the presence of the Lord. We love you and we exalt you in Jesus' precious name. God, we thank you. We take authority for every work of the enemy. We cancel every interference and every plan of evil. We frustrate the plans of Satan by the power of the blood of Jesus. We declare that this atmosphere is saturated with the glory of God. The presence of God is here. Hallelujah. The blood of Jesus soaks every individual. We thank that every plan of evil is destroyed and rebuked by the power of the mighty name of Jesus. And that, Lord, you'll have your way and glorify yourself in this place in Jesus' precious name. And all of us said, amen. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Could you please give the Lord one more hand clap of praise before we sit down? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen and amen. Please say hello to the person next to you on my behalf and tell them, Izo, umesalimiwa na brother John. Bwana asifiwe sana. Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord today. Hallelujah. Thank you so much, Bishop, for the privilege of being here today to just be together and to spend some time together these next few days as we just look into the Word of God and desire for the Lord to speak to our hearts. I am so grateful. I thank God for Bishop and, you know, and for Mama as well. Thank you very much for the wonderful blessing that they are. How many of you agree that Bishop and his wife are a tremendous blessing, not only to you guys, but to the body of Christ? Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm sure you know that. Amen. Buenas son. I really do appreciate Bishop from the bottom of my heart. Thank you so much. I honor him and respect him as a man of God, a wonderful servant of God. I think last time when we were here during the service, I mentioned, you know, that Bishop Kimani is one of the few bishops that you feel very free with at all times, whenever you are. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Anajua jinsi ya kuweza kushiriki na kila moja wetu. Japo mahali ambapo Bwana amemuinua. Bwana asifiwe, si ni kweli? To God be the glory. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Well, Jesus is Lord. Amen. Jesus is Lord. Amen. Would you please stand with me in your Bible to the book of Genesis chapter 1? And we're going to be sharing just straight really from my spirit what I sense the Lord put in my heart today for us. And I'm so excited here today. Maybe I'm more excited about being here tonight for, you know, to hear the word of the Lord than you are. Hallelujah. Because I'm so excited. I believe God has something that he wants to just put in our hearts together tonight. And I'm happy I'm a part of those who get to partake of what God has intended for you. Amen. Genesis chapter 1, and if you will please turn to the verse there, verse number 28. And we're going to read that, and then we'll be able to just share briefly from the word of God. It says here, then God blessed them. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 28. It says, God blessed them. God is always a good God. He's always blessing people. Hallelujah. From the very beginning, the first thing that God did for Adam and Eve after he created them, he blessed them. And it says here, he blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply. You notice he didn't tell them, do fruitfulness. Hallelujah. He just said, be. Muwe hivyo. Iwe ni necha yenu. You know, when you do something, you can do it occasionally. But when you have something, you're that all the time. And so God said, be fruitful. I mean, can you imagine? That's a supernatural impartation of the capacity and the ability to be fruitful. And God said, be fruitful, multiply. Hallelujah. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. God gave them a great place of authority and dominion. Scholars say that there's actually seven blessings in that one verse. There's sevenfold Edenic blessing. We can look into that maybe another time. But the point I want to make is that God really blessed the Adam and Eve at the moment they began their life. Now, I want you to just close your Bible. Hallelujah. And we'll come back to that verse at one point. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Wow, thank you again. I just want to appreciate, I think the worship team, the Rosier, did a wonderful job. I know we didn't really go for it because of time, but I could tell that there's something there. Amen. The grace of God is there, and that's wonderful. Hallelujah. Can I just share from my heart? Amen. You know, as I've been preparing my heart and getting ready for these times together, the Lord really spoke to my heart. That what the Lord wants to do together with us these few days is to speak to the core passions of this ministry. God desires to speak to the very core passions that drive and run and motivate this ministry and this church. And as I've been waiting on the Lord, I just sensed in my heart that the Lord really put it in me that one of the key and the core passions of this ministry and this church is building people. Building people. One of the things that that is a great joy, that is a great delight, that brings great satisfaction, that brings great fulfillment to the leadership and to the ministers in this house is seeing people built. Building people, developing people, growing people up. There is a great delight and a great joy and a great satisfaction that the leadership in this congregation, and I'm sure Bishop and Mama can correct me if I'm wrong, is just what I felt from the Holy Ghost. That one of the core passions of this congregation, one of the core passions of this ministry, one of the core passions that drive what happens here is the desire to see people built, people growing up, people developed in their callings, in their ways, in their lives, that there is a growing up, there's a development within the lives of those that come to this place. Hallelujah. It's a core passion. And God wants to speak that core passion today, I believe, and stir it up because there's something that God is desiring to do to raise up something, to raise up and to work with those who he has placed such a passion in, because this time demands, this season we're in demands people like yourselves. As a ministry, It's not just a value, it's a passion to develop people. So in other words, you as a congregation and as a ministry here, you love to bring the king out of the shepherd. Hallelujah. You know, you're those that the core passion, the thing that is thrilling and exciting in this congregation, in this church, and I'm just sharing what I felt from my heart. There's a joy in being able to see a shepherd boy watching over some few sheep and working with them and bringing out the king that is hidden under all those, under that shepherd boy. There's a king inside, and there's a joy in seeing that shepherd boy traverse their journey and become the king of Israel. You love to see the queen in the ordinary Esthers of life. There's just a delight to see, you know, the Esthers, the girls, the slave girls, the captive girls, the girls in exile that have a mighty anointing of God, that have a destiny to become the queen. You love to watch them and you love to see those sorts of individuals that perhaps despise themselves and don't know who they are. They see themselves defined by their environment and defined by their circumstances. So you love to watch for girls and women and people and boys and girls like that and be able to bring them from their circumstance and cause them to realize that they are appointed for such a time. As is that there's a time and a destiny that God only brought them to incubate them in their situation, in their circumstances that seemed so negative, that God was only all the time looking that as an incubation process and bringing them to a season and a time when he by supernatural means brings them up and places them in the palace as the queen of the entire empire. There's a joy in this minister that loves to see, you know, the champion come out of the ordinary. It's no wonder that Bishop was talking about the lady that beset and eventually overtook in Congo. There's something here that God has placed and is a passion in this ministry, in this house. You love to bring the prophet out of the little boy, and there's just a delight in doing that. Now, that compassion is the distinguishing thumbprint of this ministry, even in the family of ministries that you belong to. You know, Bishop, I just felt, this is a very unusual message for me to preach because I sense God is speaking primarily to those that God has connected to this house, that called this house home, and yet there's a desire in God's heart to stir up and to communicate some things that connect you here, that God wants to stir up in your heart so you can appreciate why you're here. It's not by accident that you're connected here. There's thing that God has put in you that resonates with what is inside of Bishop and his wife. That there's a resonance. What vibrates inside of them vibrates inside of you. And you therefore there's an attraction. There's a mutual attraction. You want to be here. You feel like being here. God has brought you here. But what is that thing? What is it? Let me just share with you. I believe it's that thing that God has put inside of Bishop and his wife and the leadership of this house to see people raised up and built up and developed and entered the fullness of their destiny as grown-up men and women who know who they are and can be able to perform the will of God for their life. Now, I believe that's one of the reasons why, because growing and building people is a core passion. I believe that's one of the reasons why sales is such a central part of the life of this church. Because sales grow people up. Not only those who are attendees of the cell, but the cell leaders as well grow up in the process of leading. So, as a ministry, as a congregation, there's a calling, there's a grace of God upon this ministry and church and congregation to be those that are involved in the process of bringing people from where they are at to where they need to go. So let me say this. As a member, as a part of this ministry, that means two things for you. If this is where God has planted you, then it means automatically two things. Number one, it means prepare for the greatness in you to be drawn out. Hallelujah. If you call this home, if this is where you belong, then prepare for two things. Number one, prepare for the greatness inside of you to be pulled out and to be drawn out by the Lord. Hallelujah. I believe you're there. I said, if this is where God has planted you, then it naturally, automatically means two things. Get ready, number one, for the greatness in you to be done. This is a house which delights in bringing potential out into the product. You delight to take the potential out and turn it into the product. So whatever potential you have, Get ready, because in this house there is a stirring, there is a grace, there is an enabling, there is an empowerment to turn your potential into the real product. Are we together? You need to be ready for that. That means you cannot be comfortable in this house to just remain at infancy stages in your life. Anything that God has put in you, as long as you're a part of this house, there's something that God wants to do to take that potential in you and convert it into the product He intended it to be. God never sent you here to be warm and to be filled and to be happy. Yes, those are all things that are part of the process, but that's not all. God's main intention, the reason God makes it warm, the reason God makes it happy, the reason God facilitates joy and peace and goodness and all that, is because in the process of you enjoying that, God's gonna take you from here and take you all the way to where you're supposed to be. Can somebody say amen? You are somebody that's waiting to manifest. There's a king in you that is meant to come out of that shepherd boy. There's a queen in you that is meant to come out of you. There's something that God has put inside of you that's supposed to come out. I said it's supposed to come out. Hallelujah. And you're in the right place. It's a place for bringing out greatness. So if you're a part of this congregation, if you're a part of this house, God is saying to you, get ready for the greatness in you to be drawn out. Glory to God. How dare you deny us the greatness that God put inside of you? How dare you die and go to heaven with all the capability and the potential that God put inside of you that was supposed to affect people, hundreds and thousands and millions of people? How dare you keep and compact that goodness and that greatness inside of you and never let it out? You will not be allowed to do that here, because God is getting ready to start your boat. God's getting ready to start your spirit and cause the greatness inside of you to come out. So you, what you can do is cooperate with God. You better get ready to cooperate with God and say, God, okay, all right, amen, here we go. I never thought I was going to go through this process. I never thought I'll be required to go this way. But God, here I am. If you want to bring out the greatness inside of me, I don't think there is much. But God, if you think there is much, if you think what is inside of me is worth bringing out, then God, here I am. That's the right attitude. That's the right position for you to take. That's what you need to support. That's how you need to support the process of what God is doing in your life today. There is a great king inside of you that is supposed to manifest. Glory to God. Oh, hallelujah. Let me tell you, God looked at 120 disciples. Hallelujah. On the day of Pentecost, the Holy Ghost came upon 120 disciples, and God used 120 men and women to turn the world upside down. It's because of those 120 that you and I are here today. I want you to know God can do it again. Hello, I said somebody, God can do it again. If God could use those 120 who are ordinary people just like you and I, people who doubted Jesus even when they saw him in the flesh, how about you and I who have at least been able to believe in Christ without seeing him? Glory to God. God can use you and God can transform your life. So that's number one. Get ready for the greatness you need to be drawn out. Number two, get ready to be used to draw out somebody else's greatness. Hallelujah, church. Are we together? Get ready for God to bring out greatness in other people through your life, your involvement, your participation, your cooperation with God will be used by God to draw out the greatness in other people's lives. Because in this house, one of the core passions is building people, developing people, raising people up, raising champions, raising men and women who are conquerors, who are able to overcome, men and women who live victoriously, men and women who can stand in the midst of a crooked and a perverse generation and stand out like a light shining in the darkness. That's what God has called you to be a part of in this house. You are called to be a part of a conquering, victorious people, because God desires to raise you up. That's why you're here. This is a place where God has put a passion and a desire and a fulfillment and a satisfaction in seeing people raised up, built up, developed. Hallelujah. But you see, to go from the potential stage to the product stage requires process. Everybody say process. There's a process in converting the potential into the product. Process. Many people don't like process. In today's world, we are a very instant generation. Starting from instant coffee, instant tea, instant email, instant WhatsApp, instant communication, instant food, instant everything, to the point where we forget process. Instancy takes process out of the situation. Computers process so fast that they don't allow you the time, or you don't need to take the time to process anything, because it's being processed by somebody else. That's where it becomes very interesting, because with God, it's not going to be somebody else that's going to be processed on your behalf and you come out the product. More than you, Russia. Are we together? In God's economy, he's not going to process Moses so she can come out the product. Now, if Moses gets processed, Moses will come out the product. Hallelujah. And so God wants to process us. There's a process to come from the potential to the product. And a lot of that process involves a lot of correction and discipline and training and pruning and changing. There's a lot of things involved in the process. But for the sake of tonight, I really felt in my heart the Lord was just focusing on one area of processing, and that is the area. In fact, this is very central to how the processes here, you know, from what I sense in my spirit, work. And that is this: the process that you need as a part of this body to capture and to catch and to appreciate is the process of learning responsibility. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Learning responsibility, part of the process, part of your being processed. Mojoapo katika zile hatua za kupitia mikakati ya kufanyika kile ambacho Mungu ametamania ufanyike, kwamba wewe utapitia mikakati yake ya kuweza kufanyika, utoke kwenye hali ya kuwa rasilimali ya kawaida mpaka uweze kuwa refined and come out as a product. One of those things that God wants to do is for you and I to learn responsibility. And not only to learn responsibility, but also, number two, to learn to take care of it well. So it's to learn responsibility and to learn to take care of it well. Hallelujah. Glory. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. God's desire and purpose is to process the people who come here, the people who have come to the house of building, who have come to the place of building, who've come to the place of development, who've come to the place of being developed, who've come to the place of being grown up. One of the things that God wants you to capture and to catch, the process you go through in the process of growing up, is learning responsibility. And number two, learning to take care of responsibility with excellence. By the time God processes you, when you come out the product, one of the clear distinguishable characteristics that you'll bear is that you're a person who knows how to take responsibility. You've learned responsibility, and so you are responsible. You've learned how to push aside excuses. You don't live a life of excuses this and excuses that. I wish I could. I could have done an idea. I should. No, you take responsibility, and not only do you take responsibility, but you take care of it well. With excellence. And so, in other words, when you're going through the process and you drop the ball and you're not responsible and you don't take care of your responsibility, somebody will come behind you to say, "Hello, buddy, you need to take care of your responsibility. Remember, you are responsible. You are responsible." And even when you take care of the responsibility, because of what God wants to do in and through this house, God will not be satisfied with just you being able to take responsibility. His goal and desire is that you will take care of that responsibility with excellence.
Hallelujah. Bwana asifiwe sana.
You see, one of the biggest issues for many believers, especially with this 2000 Kenyan Christianity,
millennial Kenyan Christianity, if we can call it that. One of the biggest challenges and issues is that when TBN came in and we started watching T.D. Jakes preaching and watching Ben Hinn preaching and watching, you know, all the people that you know preaching, we came into this idea. You know, we became Americanized in our thinking about the gospel. And so now, a lot of believers in Nairobi and Kenya, all around the world, believe in this idea of, you know, we are supposed to be comfortable. You know, if God is blessing me, I need to have at least 3 cars waiting for me out there. I need to live in a mansion on earth. You know, I need to have all these things, and fail to take responsibility. Let me tell you something. This is my personal conviction. I believe kupanda mbegu ni nzuri. It's scriptural. It's in the word. But you know, that's not the only thing that is in the word. Today I was talking to my daughter. You know, she needed to work on her scripture memory. You know, and she was preferring to do, you know, her English work and her math work and all that. I said to her, what do you think of a person if you saw that person and their head was oversized? They have a bigger head than their arms. You know, the proportionality of the arms and the legs to the head is off. What do you consider somebody like that? Ama mikono na miguu imekuwa mirefu imeendelea kukua lakini kichwa ni kidogo sana. Isn't something off with that picture? Will you be happy to go and will you enjoy that person as, you know, all the time you're around them will be thinking, hey, I wonder, come on, is he well? Is he fine? Why? Because of disproportionality. And when we overemphasize one side over than the other, then it becomes an issue. Anyway, I don't want to go into that. But I'm just saying that what happened is we became, a lot of American thinking seeped into the gospel. So we became a prosperity-minded church, by and large. And so now we think of instant blessing, instant gratification. We want, you know, I heard of an individual who said he's going to sell his Volkswagen Beetle and expected God to bring back a Mercedes the next day. Glory to God. Panda mbegu ya ajabu. That is not called kupanda mbegu. That is called greed and covetousness. And that's not what God has designed for us. God wants us to be blessed. God wants, from Genesis 1, we read it. He wants us to be blessed. But there's other areas of development and growth that need to come into the picture. Glory to God, so that when we are blessed, we walk like people who know and understand what blessing is. That's why you're in this house. Because this house is all about growing people, developing people, building people up. Glory to God. Come on, somebody. Say, I'm growing, I'm growing, I'm growing, I'm growing proportionally. Amen. So the process, one of the things that God wants you to do is to go through the process and not just, you know, casually, but learn to take responsibility and learn how to do it well. Process takes time. You know, there's a Chinese guy. He went to America for the first time, you know, from China way back in the 1940s or something. So he goes into America and he sees all these huge supermarkets. So this is instant coffee. Wow. Instant tea, fantastic. And then he saw, you know, not instant. He was seeing powder this, powder tea, powder coffee. He saw powdered milk. He said, "What happens with powdered milk?" He said, "You know, if you just take the powder, you add some water to it, it becomes milk." He said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "Wow, amazing." Then he saw powdered potatoes. He said, what's with this? He said, if you put water in these potatoes, it will become actual potatoes. You'll mash potatoes you can eat. He said, wow. Okay. Then he saw baby powder. So if you put water in this powder, mutoto atatokea hapa namna gani? You see, process is not there. Process has been taken out. No, but God wants us to appreciate that there's a process of coming from being a potential, you know, whatever you are, to the product of whatever God has purposed for you. And that process involves becoming responsible, becoming a grown-up man, becoming a grown-up woman. Take responsibility. Do work. Say yes to work. Work is not a dirty four-letter word. Work is good. Hallelujah. So God is teaching us responsibility. And not only to take care of the responsibility, but to do it well, with a spirit of excellence. You know, somebody might come behind you and say, yes, you did take care of your responsibility. You led your cell. Yes, you were there. Yes, you were at the cell meeting. Yes, you were able to lead your people, but you did not do it well. You guys met for 16 hours. That's not a cell meeting. Glory to God. That's a camp meeting. So you did take care of your responsibility, but you didn't take care of it well. It's one thing to take care of your responsibility. It's another thing to take care of it well. To excel means to surpass, to go beyond the limit, to go beyond the expected. Hallelujah, that's excelling. That's going beyond the expected. That's what God wants you to do. So people in this house, come on. I don't know if you're envying what God is saying. If you don't, I'm envying you. Because what God is saying to you in this house, you have a calling, you have a destiny to be people that God is raising up, that appreciate responsibility and know how to take care of it well. That's your destiny. That's who God has called you to be. That's why you're in this house. Because in this house, you are built, you're developed, you're grown, you're raised up to be whoever you're supposed to be. Hallelujah. I just felt as I was preparing, Bishop, that the word responsibility is going to become increasingly significant and important in this church, in this congregation. That word, just mark that word, responsibility. It's going to increasingly become a more and more important word in this ministry, responsibility. Are you responsible? Oh, we could go into that. Let me just touch on it a bit. You know, responsibility, of course, means you being able to take care of the duties and the work that is assigned to you. But the word responsibility is actually made of two words, response and able. Responsible. Are you able to respond well to what is required of you? That has a lot to do with attitude. That's a lot to do with capability. That has a lot to do with capacity. That's why you hear many organizations talking about capacity building. Why? Because they want to train people to be able to respond to the demands of the tasks that are ahead of them. Let me tell you something. God, why should God not have a people who are able to respond to the requirements of the day? Why should it be challenging for people, believers, to be able to rise up to the occasion and respond to the challenges of the hour? Why should we be scared, stiff of Islam? Why should we be scared, stiff of, you know, all these other religions, when God wants to put in us the capability and the ability to respond appropriately to whatever the challenge may be? Why should Christians cower? Why should Christians hide under the bushel? Because they don't have the ability to respond. But not in this house, because here God wants to train and to raise up a people that are able to respond and do everything that the situation requires. And having done all, brethren, to stand, stand therefore. Oh, come on, somebody. Responsible. Just mark that word. I believe it's going to be more and more important and becoming increasingly significant in this church and ministry in the days to come. Now, why will it be an important word in the days to come? Because responsibility is absolutely essential in bringing greatness out of people. Somebody has to attend to the task. Somebody has to respond to the tasks required to bring out greatness in somebody. I believe it was Michelangelo who sculpted King David. And he did such an excellent job. People asked him, how did you, from this just block of wood, how did you carve out such a beautiful image of David the king? He said, well, I just removed whatever was not David in them. He just took the chisel from the block of wood and removed whatever was not David in that block of wood. And he only left what was David. And it was a masterpiece. And that's what God wants to do in your life. Come on. Is anybody excited about God doing that in their life? I don't know about you, but let me tell you something. Let me tell you, if God was to show you who you are, you would need an introduction to yourself. Because you're so great, you'd scare yourself. I don't believe. Why do you think in heaven there'll be 30 minutes of tears? The book of Revelation says there was silence in heaven for about 30 minutes. Why? Ooh, 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 ooh. I wish ningejua. Why? Light ningejua. You mean I was supposed to be? You mean I was supposed to be? Why?
That's my own thinking. I think people will be crying. I think there'll be a lot of regret in heaven.
Why not go for it now? Why not just let God say, God, deal with me? I mean, just get out all of the non-David stuff in my life. Get out all the shepherdiness or whatever else, whatever, all the junk that surrounds the king in me. Get it out of my life, Lord. Remove it. And somebody's going to have to take responsibility to do that for you. That's why you guys are awesome. You guys are wonderful. You guys have an awesome privilege. God wants to bring great people out of your midst here. There's great people here that we've got to be introduced to them. It will take the full alphabet to introduce them because of all the credentials behind their name. Doctor so-and-so, professor so-and-so. You are so great, you would need the whole alphabet to describe who you are. And that's what God is jealous about. Because he didn't put deposit that greatness in you just for it to remain potential. He wants it to become the product. Can somebody say amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so the reason responsibility is going to be an important word in the days to come is because responsibility is absolutely essential in bringing out greatness in people. And what is greatness? It's simply raising people who have learned to take responsibility with excellence. That's just in a nutshell, you know, what God has designed for this congregation. To be able to raise people up who have learned to take responsibility and to do with excellence. That's greatness. If you've been through School of Leaders, you know, one of the scriptures there, the scripture we just read, one of the meanings of the word to multiply. You'll probably remember this from your School of Leaders notes. One of the meanings of the word multiply is to grow a great man. From the very beginning, one of God's desires was to grow greatness. And that just happens to be one of the core passions of this ministry. Hallelujah. Let me just share with you three reasons why God wants to raise up a people like yourselves. A people who've learned to take responsibility and to do it with excellence. Let me just share with you three quick reasons and then we'll look at one area and finish. Number one, the reason why God wants to raise up people like you, the reason why God is dealing with people who have a core passion like yours, raising greatness, building people, great people who have learned to take responsibility and to do it with excellence. What a need in the world today. Let me just share three quick reasons why that's very necessary in the hour in which you live. Come on, church. We need to be relevant. You know, Jesus said we are to be salt and light. You cannot use salt to affect a situation where salt is not. The salt must get in that environment, get in that mixture, get involved with the mess and preserve the meat out of all the rottenness because the salt is present. You cannot be salt from a distance. You've got to mingle right in there with everything else and then bring your preservational capacities into the situation and be able to bring out what God wants you to do. And so why does God want us to be, why does God want people who have learned to take responsibility with excellence? Because number one, people like you shine best in the marketplace. You shine best in the marketplace. People are tired and sick and tired of having phony believers. People who don't take responsibility. People who have no ability to respond to the demands of the situation. Christians, women who compromise because the boss wants favors in order to give them 2,000 shillings more on their paycheck. Come on. You know, people know. People understand these things. Phony believers. Come on, lady. If you don't have enough capacity to stand up for your conviction, saying no, then you have not learned to take responsibility. You need to be built up. You're still at the infancy stages. God wants people like yourselves because they shine best in the marketplace. Why? Let me just say this, and I believe Bishop can corroborate what I'm about to say. Not entirely. But by and large, in Kenya today, the church, I'm talking about the pulpit, is losing credibility. Not entirely, but by and large, there's a loss of credibility at the pulpit. The men of God no longer carry the influence they once did over people. The time when a servant of God will speak and say ABCD, and the media will rally around them and say the church has spoken, and people will take them seriously. That age has been going down, 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 down over the last 8-7 years. The voice of the men of God is no longer as audible as it once was. Does that mean that God then loses representation? Does that mean that God no longer has the ability to touch the society? No. What God is doing, what is happening is there's a shift to where, instead of where we are looking at the pulpit, we now need to look at the pew. That is why sales is right on target. Because it raises people, ordinary people, who then go into the environment and affect that environment with the glory of God. There's a shift in this nation, at least. There's a shift from where we all used to look to what the men of God are saying. And now we all want to look at what is the people around me saying. Their lifestyles speak louder sometimes than the pulpit. And that is why God is raising up men and women who know how to take care of responsibility with the spirit of excellence. They speak loudly. In the marketplace, their lives speak loudly. Ah, I want to challenge somebody here today in the name of Jesus. Come on, wherever you serve, wherever you work, can you let your light shine? Can you grow up to the place where you take responsibility with such excellence that anybody around your environment that wants to ask anything about anything, they say naturally they are drawn to you because you shine above the rest because you've learned how to take responsibility and how to do it with excellence. The move of God is shifting. God is on the move. And those who capture the heart of God will be on the move with Him. And I believe God wants to move through the pulpit, yes, but also now increasingly more through the pew. In fact, all the time through, you know, when you look at history, church history, God has always moved through the pew, even much more than through the pulpit. Because the pulpit is to equip, Ephesians 4:11 through 16. But when you are equipped, when you grow up, and you're able to take responsibility, that's the delight of the leadership. I know that's the delight of the leadership in this house, is for you to rise up and be who you are. If you're an engineer, be a Holy Ghost engineer. That when you go to the engineering field, you shine and you excel and you stand out. And therefore, your word has influence. You become salt. Because why? Because you've learned how to take responsibility and to do it with excellence. I don't know why. It's almost like believers are plagued with the spirit of mediocrity. It's like, you know, it's like churches are not supposed to be excellent. It's like believers, because we say, the grace of God. The grace of God. Brother, you know, how come you are late? The grace of God. Now, I'm not saying that there are no seasons when you can be genuinely late. There, those things happen. But I'm saying when it's an habitual situation, you know, oh, brother, you know, how come this? Oh, you know, the grace of God covers all things. It covers a multitude of sins. The scripture actually says it's the love of God that covers a multitude of sins, not the grace of God. So there's a need for men and women who take responsibility and do the excellence to rise up in this hour, because now is a time when God wants to move through those who are well practiced in such a manner. People want to see Christians who are responsible and who are excellent in their life. Come on, I believe with all my heart that God is speaking right now to you as an individual to be a part of those that He's going to use in that category, people who are excellent at taking responsibility. Gives your voice. Number two, second reason why God is interested in people like you. Hallelujah. Why is God interested in people who are responsible with the spirit of excellence? Because God, there's a wealth transfer that is about to take place. God, you know, there's a shift. God is transferring wealth. There's a wealth transfer that is happening across the nations. And Kenya is no different. The Bible says in Proverbs 13:22, a good man leaves an inheritance for his children's children, and the sinner leaves all his wealth for the righteous. There's a wealth transfer that is coming across the land. But guess what? God is not going to transfer wealth from the wicked and place it on a lazy, irresponsible, non-excellent Christian just because they're a Christian. Oh, you know, I believe in Jesus. I go to church every Sunday. I'm here every day. Oh, but I can't take responsibility. I'm not excellent. I don't know what is going on. I'm just a Christian. No, wealth will not come to you. Hello. God is going to look for people because he who is faithful with little will be entrusted with much. It's a divine principle. Unless you can demonstrate that you are faithful with the little, why should God entrust you with more? Because what you do with the little is essentially and basically what you'll do with the more. If you waste the little, you waste the more. And so when God is looking for people to give, to transfer this wealth to, he has to find people who are responsible and who are excellent in spirit in doing so. Because he knows he can entrust them with tasks and responsibilities and they will do it. Glory to God. God is stirring the spirit of this church. God is stirring the spirit of the membership of this congregation. You are here because you have an assignment in God. You've come to this station to be trained and to be grown up, to be built up, to be developed, to be raised. Because there's a place for you to go and function. So there's a wealth transfer coming. And God is not going to place his wealth on a people just because they bear the name Christian who are, you know, have you ever wondered why you find people who say they're born again, they're full of the Holy Ghost, but when you look at their lifestyle, they lie, they don't tell the truth, they, you know, bribe, they do, I mean, yeah, they say they're saved. Have you seen people like that? But they said they're saved. Akikutolea ushuhuda utasema wa huyu kweli huyu ametoka mbinguni leo. Ni kama alipata ushuhuda ulishuka kutoka kwa malaika, hata hiyo ushuhuda hata sio wake, ni malaika amemshushia. Hallelujah. Lakini ukiangalia, that's why Jesus said mtawajua kwa nini? Kwa matunda yao. So matunda ile ndio Mungu anataka. So the second thing is that you know the issue of wealth transfer. But then number three, people who have learned to take responsibility with the spirit of excellence are influencers of Godward legislation. Godward. They are influencers of Godward legislation. Again, this is just like Daniel. Remember how Daniel was so excellent in his work that the heathen king said, from this point forward, only the God of Daniel, Shadrach, and Meshach, and Abednego will be worshipped in the entire empire. Why? Because these guys had such a spirit of excellence on them. They had such, you know, they were so responsible. They were so wonderful people to the point where the king said, okay, if your God has enabled you to do that, then we want him to be worshipped across the whole nation. That's what I believe God is wanting in this hour. God is looking for people that he can use. You know, we keep complaining, you know, the government, there's corruption all over the place. Let me tell you something. When the people of God begin to rise up, when godly, life-giving believers rise up in the marketplace, what will happen is you'll begin to see that the legislation changing, influence coming to the marketplace, or all over the, you know, all over the political sphere and in the economic sector, you'll see change coming because there's a lot of influence, a lot of salt from the church that is beginning to affect the society. Hallelujah. Responsibility. Everybody say responsibility. I want us to finish tonight by just looking at one task of responsibility and then we'll be able to close. Just quickly, I think I'll be about a few minutes away. John chapter 15, please. John 15. Process. And I believe it's not just for this congregation, but, you know, really, it's an hour when God is raising, or rather God is dealing with, you know, people, individuals, taking them through the process to capture some things. Yeah, let's just quickly read John 15 verse 1. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Hallelujah. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. It doesn't say every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he prunes. Hello? It says what? Let's read together. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. So if he's not bearing fruit, we're not even considering pruning it. We're just removing it. Process. Okay? And every branch that bears fruit, that one he does what? He prunes. That it may bear more fruit. Mm-hmm. You are already clean or pruned because of the word which I've spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you, okay? As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself. Now he's talking about process here. He says, abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. In other words, fruitfulness is not a, it's not a question when you're abiding in me. That's what Jesus is implying here. He says, for without me, you can do nothing. Look at verse 6. It says, if anyone does not abide. So he says, if anyone abides, this is what will happen. If anyone does not abide, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire and they are burned. Of course, you know the famous verse 7. Okay, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire and it shall be done for you. Oftentimes we want to claim that promise, but we fail to sometimes capture what goes on behind. But let's look at verse 6 for just a moment here. Verse 6, it says, if anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered, and they gather them and throw them into the fire. The Amplifier says, cut off from vital union with me, you can do nothing. One of the key responsibilities, and I want to finish here now. One of the key responsibilities and tasks of those that God is raising up in this house is a people who know how to take the responsibility of staying vitally connected to Jesus. Nobody can take that responsibility for you. Bishop and Mama cannot take that responsibility for you. No matter how well they care for you, no matter how much they love you. You know, I Bishop, na chekeshanga watu saa zingine na wambianga, kulikuwa na mtu mwingine siku moja aliniambia, mkienda kanisani mtuombe. Nikamwambia hapana, sitakuombea. Akashuka akasema, si wewe ni pastor? Nikasema ndio. Si mnaombeanga watu? Nikasema ndio. Sasa mimi nimekuambia ukienda mkienda kanisa mniombe, mtuombe. Nikamwambia sitakuombea. Anashindwa kwa nini? Nikasema jamani, mbona hujawahi kuniambia siku ile umepika chapati na kakuku? Hujawahi kuniambia unikulie. Mkifika mesani mnikulie. Jamani, there are some things that nobody can do for you. How you want, when it comes to eating, kukula vinono vile ambavyo mchungaji alisema pale, bishop alisema kukula vinono, no one, I don't want anybody to take that responsibility for me. I am well able to take that responsibility for myself. Lakini ifika wakati wa kwenda kanisani ni kuombea. No, sita kuombea. Ninaweza kukula na wewe ushibe. Can I eat and you be satisfied? Naweza kuvaa nguo na you be clothed. Naweza kuoga na wewe uwe msafi. There are some things that nobody, you cannot delegate some things. There are some things that are totally non-delegatable. And one of those things is being able to connect with Jesus at a personal level. You've got to be able to focus on God and draw out fellowship with God by yourself. People who are going to be great in this hour are people who are going to be able to know how to stay connected to Jesus. People who know how to pray and press in prayer until the breakthrough comes out. People will not be able to sing izia wengine wasema ya kwamba mbona kanisa ni wakuniombea niliomba lakini let me tell you something. God is raising up finishers and champions in this hour. People who will do whatever is necessary, whatever it takes. If it takes prayer and fasting for 100 days, are you capable of becoming great enough to where you can handle that responsibility and bring out the results and deliver the fruit because you are able to take responsibility? Jesus said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, nobody can take the responsibility of abiding in the word for you. Hakuna mtu anaweza kukutafunia neno hili la Bwana. Yeye atafune wewe upatie upokee baraka. No. God designed it in such a way na kwamba neno linaliwa peke yako. Neno linaliwa moja binafsi, kibinafsi, kibinafsi. You eat by yourself. You are satisfied by yourself. Hallelujah. And so what God is doing, what God is raising now, is he's raising and bringing to the understanding the responsibility of being responsible to study the word by yourself, for yourself. There's greatness in you. There's absolutely amazing greatness in you. God wants to revive that greatness inside of you. But one thing that is required in this process is learning to take care of the responsibility of being personally, simply, powerfully, incredibly connected with Jesus at a one-on-one level. Glory to God. Let me ask you this. Are you happy with your prayer life? Are you content with your prayer? Do you sometimes feel, you know, I think I should pray more. Or I can pray more. You know what we do? We say, you know, I know I should be praying more, but mazeni mechoka sana. Unajua hali vile zinakuanga jo, squeeze magari matatu manini. Hata highway haijasaidia. Nahitaji kuomba lakini nikifika nyumbani mazoe nimechoka. Alafu nimesota. Nikifika tu kwa bed ni kulala tu hata sisemangi amen, nasemanga amen asubuhi nikiamka. Lakini God an understand tu. Ju God ni mpoa sana, ni Buddha mwingine deadly sana. Hapana, kwanza God ni Buddha lively sio deadly. But you know what? We excuse ourselves and say we can't do this. We find good reasons why we cannot pray. We find good reasons why we are not able to pray as much as we know we should. Let me tell you something. There's something called the flesh. And the flesh will give you 10,000 reasons why you can't get up and pray, why you can't get up at 3 and pray, why you can't get up at 5 and get ready for. You know, it's amazing, Bishop. People will get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, prepare for work, even if it's raining. If it's a Monday or Tuesday, they'll be on the road. They'll do whatever they need to do to get to work because they must be there because they'll earn some money. When it comes to church on Sunday, it's raining in the morning. Even God will understand. Ine kumenyesha asubuhi. Those are not going to be the conquering Christians that God is going to take you to the next level. People have to grow up and realize, I am responsible. I will do what the task requires for me to fulfill the responsibility I have. I will find the means and ways to do my duty, no matter what is the barrier on the way. That is what God is talking about today. That God wants you to come to that level where you make a personal decision on the inside of your heart that no matter what comes my way, every challenge that comes my way is not an obstacle, it's an opportunity for me to grow more, to demonstrate the greatness in me. Let me tell you something. There are obstacles you don't even know exist right now. There are some challenges you've never even heard about. Things will come your way that will challenge you like you've never had anybody else challenged. But can I give you the good news? You have been inbuilt with greatness on the inside of you. When you get to that place, when you get to that situation that you don't know about, that you've never had anybody else deal with, you don't know how, you have no clue, you have no reference. Let me tell you, let me encourage you. You have within you an inbuilt mechanism by the Holy Ghost to enable you, to draw out of you, to summon strength from somewhere deep down inside of you to overcome that situation, and you will be the pattern. You'll be able to testify and say, this came my way, but here's how God helped me to overcome it in Jesus' name. There's greatness in you. And if you are given to excuses, the devil will provide plenty of them for you to remain right where you are. Can I tell you something, Deliverance Church Zimmerman? God is saying the time to singizia is over. Responsibility is going to become a word that is increasingly important in this ministry and congregation and church in the days to come, because God has equipped you already with the ability to be equal to the task. Everybody say equal to the task. Say I'm equal to the task. There's an ability in you to handle anything. That's not to say that it'll be easy. But you know what? As you stretch and find from somewhere within your relationship with God the resources necessary to overcome this barrier, as you stretch, you will grow. Let me finish with this story. I wish you had time. I feel like now we are starting to preach now, Bishop. Let me tell you, I'm so excited. Listen, I believe in you. I know, because God spoke it to my heart. I know it's the truth. God has brought you here because this is a house that builds people up. And part of that building is to charge you with the capacity and to train you and to equip you with the ability to take responsibility. Many believers don't take responsibility, much less with excellence. Many believers want somebody else to do the work and they receive the credit. They want somebody else to do the work and they receive the glory. They don't want work. But do you realize that when God created Adam, the first thing he did even before the wife came was give him responsibility to work and tend the garden. God loves work. And there has to be a shift in attitude in many of our lives today to where work is good, is a good thing, especially work that God has assigned me. We need to finish. One day, a young man came across a cocoon of a butterfly. You know how butterflies grow. There's stages. There's the egg, there's the larva, then there's the pupa, and then there's the adult, that's right. So this young boy was walking somewhere and he found this little caterpillar had spun a cocoon around itself, and it was at the pupa stage. And he knew from school, this one is just about to become a butterfly. So what he did, he looked inside and he saw this cocoon. You know, the butterfly was, there's beginning to be some wings. And he said, I'm going to take this and I'm going to keep it and watch the butterfly grow. But what I'm going to do, because I want to see this happen, I'm going to break the cocoon and help the butterfly to remove its wings. Which he did. And he watched his butterfly remain lame for the rest of its life. It never was able to fly. It had thin, short, emaciated wings that other butterflies don't have. And he wondered why. But what he didn't realize is that the pressure of the cocoon restricting the wings from coming out was necessary to create the wings to form fully. That cocoon is there for a reason. The more the wings of the butterfly stretch and strengthen until they're able to overcome the cocoon, at that stage, that's when the wings are ready to also fly. I want to encourage somebody here today. You are here, and there's responsibilities pressing in on every side of your life. And here you are, trying as much as you can to push against those duties and responsibilities and to fulfill the tasks that are assigned to your life or the tasks that you find surrounding your life. Can I encourage you? You might well be in that cocoon right now this evening. God is using that pressure to develop the capacities he put in you because they're already inside of you. God is not going to come and put something in you that was never there before. Yes, God can anoint you. God can strengthen you. But the capacities that he put in you way before even the world began, God knew you would be this and that. God knew you'd be in this age. God knew you'd be in this situation. And so God put in you the capacities and the strength to be able to stretch out and to overcome the barriers and the barricades and be able to come up higher and fly above the things that initially were obstacles in your life. You can look over them now and say, bye-bye, you little obstacles. Here I am flying high because of the grace of God and the ability that God has put in my life. Come on, can I encourage somebody here today? Don't quit in being responsible. Don't quit in being excellent. Don't quit in pushing out. Don't quit in resisting the situations that you're dealing with, because God is using those things only as building blocks to bring out the greatness inside of you. Somebody say amen. Let's all stand, please. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for tonight. Thank you for your word. Thank you because, God, you desire to raise up responsible, excellent believers. I pray now, Father God, for every one of us today, in the name of Jesus Christ, that, Lord, there will be a supernatural Holy Ghost impartation, Lord, of strength and courage. Bible says, God, you have not given us a spirit of fear, but one of love, of power, and of a sound mind. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus today for every single person here and even those of the larger congregation that, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, there's coming a shift in attitude where, God, responsibility is not something to be avoided, but it's something to be overcome. It's something to be fulfilled with joy and delight. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray, Father God, that, Lord, something will happen here. Lord, you'll stir up, oh God. First and foremost, I pray, in fact, Lord, that you stir up on the inside of us, Lord, the knowing of the greatness you've placed inside of us. Come on. I want to invite you just to please place your hand over your belly right now. Just put your hand over your belly where your spirit leaves. Let's just pray that God will start. Just say, Lord, stir my spirit towards the greatness you've placed in me, in the name of Jesus. Let's just pray that prayer for just a moment right now. Just pray, Lord, stir my spirit, stir my heart, oh God, stir my spirit, my Father. I pray, God, remove complacency, remove fatigue, remove compromise, remove, Lord, every kind of barrier. Marosa kalanda laboseta labaka rosoto loboko robo. Oh, star, oh God, star, oh God, star the greatness, star up on the inside, the greatness you place in me, my Father. Oh, I pray, God, that I'll be greater. Fulfill the greatness, the calling of God upon my life. The calling of God upon my life, I will fulfill in the name of Jesus. Now place your hand over your mind, over your head, if you would, just a moment. Just say, Lord, I shift my attitude in the name of Jesus from seeing responsibility as something to be avoided. Now, I embrace responsibility with joy and with excellence in Jesus' name. Come on, let's pray. Let's pray that prayer right now. Father, I thank you. And my mind accepts. I embrace. Oh, Father, I choose. I decide. Responsibility is good. Responsibility is good. I embrace responsibility. My God. I thank you, Lord. I thank you that indeed, my Father, from this day forward, my mind appreciates. I welcome responsibility. Enjoy it, and I do the excellence for the glory of God in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We give you glory, Father. We give you honor. We give you thanks today, Lord. I pray that, Lord, even as we leave this service, God, we go home praying and start up on the inside, revive towards our purpose and our calling. Ah, God, do not let any of us settle with this littleness and the smallness of our vision, the smallness of our accomplishments, smallness of what we've seen done, Lord. Ah, I pray, God, that you stir our hearts to dream big and to desire to see God do mighty things through me. Yes, even me, even though I see myself as an ordinary, simple individual, yet, God, I believe there's greatness on the inside of me. I will not avoid responsibility. I will embrace it and take it joy to the glory of God. Glory to God. Maybe you're here tonight and we are talking about responsibility. We're talking about connecting with Jesus. We're talking about spending time in the Word. But you've never met Jesus. You've never come into fellowship with Jesus. You've never known the wonder of His person. You know, a lot of people see Jesus from outside and they describe Him from outside. They talk about His miracles from outside. They talk about the Son of God from an external perspective. But I want to encourage you today, if you've never met Jesus, you can know Him and testify of Him from the inside. That you can know Jesus from the inside and walk in fellowship with Him. If you're here tonight and you've never given your life to Christ, it will be our joy and our delight tonight to pray for you and bless you in the name of the Lord. Is there any such individual? You say, what? You know what? I want to receive Christ I want to receive prayer. I want to fellowship with Jesus. I want to enter into a permanent, covenant, intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. Would you raise your hand wherever you are? Just wave it so we can sit and pray for you. Any individual, just raise your hand if you're here. You're saying, I want to receive prayer for that. Is there any individual? Anyone? I tell you, this is a wonderful environment for you to embrace Christ and to enter into an intimate fellowship with Him. Oh, the wonders of the Son of God. Nobody can fully describe. But I want to just pray for you. Is there any individual? Just raise your hand high if you're raising your hand. Anybody? Hallelujah. We love you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for your goodness and your grace. I pray the cover of the blood of Jesus over each and every one of us, O God. Keep us and protect us, Lord. Bring us back together at the appointed hour, we pray. In Jesus' name. Everybody say it, amen.